The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this edition with the other half of the Fair City Saints. You may have heard a previous episode with Alex Webb. I'm joined by the other half, Air Myles. Welcome to the show.
Thanks you for having me.
So super excited for this because I think I may have seen your debut. If we'll go through the timeline as we jump around this interview. So it's quite cool that I would have seen you right at the start and now we're having a chat. Yes. However, many years later. But the first question is the same. It's the same standard question every wrestler gets asked in an interview. What got you hooked into pro wrestling?
Now, this might be a bit odd for a lot of people to accept, but I'm a lot younger than what I look. And I only started watching wrestling in 2006. So I missed a lot of the big things that people talk about, the Attitude Era and stuff like that. So the first time I watched wrestling myself was, it was at my friend's house, and it was a repeat of SmackDown where Batista just came back from his injury. I think that was after Mark Henry had taken him out in a steel cage. And I just watched that, and the first thing I liked was just the music, because I like rock music. And then just seeing this guy come out and just beating people up, it was just, it just kind of looked cool. And then a friend had a trampoline, and my other friends were quite into wrestling. So they were like doing wrestling moves on trampoline, as you do when you're a kid. And then it was during the summer holidays. And then that night, there was, I think it was a taping of ECW, and I think it was actually the one that CM Punk debuted, and I just started watching that, and then so on, and then the ball kind of, it was like a snowball effect. I just kept watching it. Like, you got the 5 p.m. repeats on Sky Sports, so I was watching, I think there was, the ones that I remember was the Triple Threat, Edge, RVD and John Cena for the championship, the one that RVD lost. So they were like my first sort of memories of watching wrestling, and it's just kind of taken on from there. So that's how it kind of started, and instantly I just kind of became hooked off it. Like I said, music, just the big, like, over the top entrances, just big over the top guys, and it's very weird for me to look back and think that the main first person I ever watched in wrestling was Batista. But it's still something I still go on about today, because I absolutely love the guy.
Speaking about the music, that it's weird when I'm just a big, I like pop. That's my kind of music. Pop, yeah. Maybe show tunes. And then when you go through my playlist, it's like, I don't know, something from Wicked or something from Hairspray.
Musicals, and yeah.
Something terribly boy bandish. And then Saliva. Because of Batista, and then Metalingus by Alter Bridge because of Edge, and it's weird how this music just getting ingrained. When it comes to wrestling, though, I suppose you would have seen it if you've started that role. You may not have been aware of it, but as soon as you are, it's everywhere. It's like you go, oh, I haven't seen this before, and as soon as you look at the schedule the next day, it's, oh, there's wrestling there, and there's ECW there, and there's all that kind of stuff. It's weird how it goes so under the radar, and then once it's on it, you can't miss wrestling. It's odd.
Well, this was back in the day when you used to get, I think, I can't remember the name of the channel, but it was channel 427 on Sky, and that's where TNA and Ring of Honor, and you had all, I think even the Mexican stuff was on there as well, and it was just a channel dedicated to just either mixed martial arts or wrestling. And then, like, no one would have known about it, but then it was just by chance I came across it one day, and it's like, oh, have you never heard of that? I was like, no, what is this? So yeah, it's like you said, just by chance, you you're noticing like repeats. And then I think on Sky One, you were getting Afterburn,
yeah,
Heat and stuff. That I was like, all right, okay, cool. This is for like parents cancelled Sky, or I didn't have Sky at the time, so I was getting all this stuff as well. So yeah,
The wrestling channel was what I remember it as. They changed it to something else. I think they might change it to the Fight Network towards the end because it took off all the wrestling.
Yeah.
But no, I remember watching TNA. Oh man, that was my first TNA experience, 2004. And then just TNA was the best thing ever at that point. I remember we did an interview with you like 2019, just like these five questions or start for 10 things. Yeah. And I remember you mentioned TNA as well. So it's a bit of a different chain, different pace when you go from Batista, humongous dude, to TNA, which didn't really have humongous guys at that point, except Abyss, but in a different way. So what was it about TNA that kind of just drew you in?
I think it's kind of like you said, it was just something that was completely different. Like Batista, John Cena, all these guys, these were just big powerhousey guys. But you then went on to TNA and they were just, it was just a completely different kettle of fish where the guys were small. They weren't necessarily like, they were lean, but they weren't exactly muscly, but then they were like jumping about the ring like nothing I'd ever seen. It was just, and that, as you could probably watch in my earlier matches or more recent, is that's a style that instantly triggered with me because it was just something I had never seen before. And I was like, I never had associated that as a kind of form of wrestling. It was always just kind of your big American showman stuff, but then at the same time there was this also in America, but they were doing just flips off the ropes and stuff, and it was great. So
how did you get from that to thinking, you know what, I've done the trampoline stuff, I'm assuming you did backyarding as well because everyone did at some point, whether they want to admit it or not. How did you go from that to actually going, oh no, I think I'm gonna just give this a go myself?
So, yeah, I'm not going to lie. I did do a lot of wrestling on the trampoline, and consequently, I broke quite a few trampolines along the way. But my friend and I, we always said, oh, it'd be really good if we could be a tag team. And we always wanted to be called The Connection, just because, you know, tag teams connect stuff. So, yeah, I'm not ashamed to admit that one, huh?
I've heard worse. I used to do e-fedding. Yeah. I've heard a lot worse.
There you go. But we always said, oh, we'll be a tag team and stuff. Yeah. And then it kind of stopped, the idea of it. And then there was a show in Perth at the Jewers Centre. And my mum was at the Jewers Centre and I was getting picked up. So I went in. And in the like 48 foyer, but there was a pop-up banner with Ted DiBiase on it, and then had a link to a website. I was like, oh, okay. So I was interested in going. So I went on the website, and then I noticed on the website it said training. And I was like, all right. Because my whole, I was never like I was always quite a skinny kid. So everyone always said, oh, you'll never, you're too small to be a wrestler. And I was like, oh, okay, fair enough. And then I seen it and I went, actually, no, I'm going to give it a go. So messaged the promotion, said, yeah, can I come? And said, yeah, sure. And I didn't go the first time. And I then, because I wanted to go with my friend, because I always said we'd be a tag team. And I waited a year and I said, nah, I don't think you're interested as much as I am. So I then eventually went myself, and that's basically it. It's all because of a pop-up banner in the Jewers Centre. And that's when I went, oh, maybe it is possible. So
did you go to that show at the Jewers Centre?
No, because it said it was sold out.
That'd be very weird because that I was at that show. So I was just going to be...
Right.
Yeah, that was my first show, Scottish wrestling show. And Ted DiBiase and that. So that was a weird... thought it'd be a weird... path crossing without even realizing sort of thing, but no, I went to that one. Did you follow that? Did you go to any of those shows during that year? Did you go to any of their shows, or was it because they were in Dundee and that you just didn't go over it? Or
no, it was mainly because it was just in, because that was in Perth, it caught my attention. And I just never, I was at college at the time as well. I think at that point I just left school and I was starting college. Therefore, I put a bit of focus into that. I went, okay, go and do it. I went to study engineering. And it got to the end of the year. I was just kind of like, I don't know what to do. I never really knew what I wanted to do when I came out of school anyway. And it just so happened I managed to get into this course. And then got to the end of the course and I went, still don't really know what I want to do. So, and then I just went, I'll check the website again and said, oh, there's, and training's still being offered. So I just went, like, messaged the page. They said, come along. I think they didn't remember me, but because otherwise they go, did you not dingy us a year ago? But I then went that the following, exactly 1 year after I messaged, I joined, went to start training to become a wrestler.
So you did a bit of, like, so you did a bit of trampoline wrestling. What was that first couple of sessions like when you went in, when you found, well, I'm assuming you already knew wrestling wasn't totally legit, but when you went in, how was it a bit of a culture shock? Were you just like so surprised at how much more work it was going to be? What was your first reaction?
I never expected it to be easy, but my God, just from running the ropes was my first memory. And I've actually got the pictures. I found them recently, is the marks that were left on my back the next day. I was a broken man the next day. It was, oh, because we were doing stuff that my body hadn't been trained to do, like, or using muscles it had never used before, especially in the neck for protective reasons. And oh, it was just so stiff. And it's clear, it's obviously something that happens to everybody, that because everyone I spoke to, they're like, oh, the second day is the worst. But yeah, it was very eye-opening as well, because you're kind of learning how to do things properly and stuff like that. So it was really eye-opening in that aspect, because obviously I'd known bits and bobs of it. But yeah,
and it's one of those things, if you're on a trampoline and it's
very different to bumping on or landing on a trampoline. But I kept going, so that was a good thing. It didn't scare me away. I think the first session I ever did was actually with Kevin Williams. He was my first ever training session.
He could be a bit of a taskmaster as it is. So yeah, you would have been feeling the repercussions of that. Yeah. But I remember seeing the ring getting built, and if I remember rightly, there was very little by way of padding. So I can only imagine how sore that would have been.
Yeah, varies from place to place, but sometimes it could be a bit rationed, let's put it that way. I think I was quite grateful in the sense that they just got a new ring, so I was quite fortunate in that aspect, because I've used both rings at that training school, and the new ring was much better than the old one. So
I don't doubt that for a second. So yeah. how long was it before you were kind of told that you'd be making a debut then?
So depends what you class as my debut. I started appearing on shows 4 months after my first training session, and I wrestled my first match, I want to say 8 months after. So I started appearing on shows in January 2014. That was my first ever show. It's actually quite, looking back on it, it's quite bizarre, because I don't think I was show ready, but I was 19, and they were like, yeah, you want to be on a wrestling show? And I was like, yeah. And I think the only reason that I was put in that position was because I was able to do a 450. And that is genuinely the case. They wanted new people on the shows. Here's a guy that can do a 450. Can't do anything else, but you can do a 450. So there you go, right? And I remember watching the footage back, and yeah, it got a great pop. And here's me thinking I'm cool as hell, but yeah, couldn't, very limited at that point. And it kind of showed. And I wish, if I was older, I might have said, actually, you know what, can I just hold off until I'm a bit more confident? But like I said, 19 years old, getting asked to do, well, go on a show, doing what he's there to do. So it's like, yeah, I'll take that chance.
I was at that show then, or he said January 14. I was there. Because was it that show that it was 3 years? It was a Trident. And yes. Were you having to sit in the crowd with a mask on for part of the show?
That was the next show after. Right. Still don't understand why the mask thing was there, but yes, we had to sit in the crowds and with wrestlers' masks on. I think I had was it Rey Mysterio mask? But yeah, there was one of the guys in the group was huge, like, and he was just sitting there and with this mask on, and it's like, well, that doesn't look odd at all. Like me, I was, you know, I was quite skinny, so I was able to get away and look like a fan. This guy was absolutely huge, broad shoulders, muscles like you wouldn't believe, and he's just sitting there with a wrestler's mask on. So yeah.
It wasn't the most low key, because the smaller member was two, like four seats that side of me, and yeah. I spotted him. I was like, going, what are you doing? Where are you? You're that's weird. Yeah. You shouldn't be. that's just odd to look at. And then yeah, the other member was the other side of the hall, and I was looking at him going, you're huge and you've got a mask on too. Yeah, something's happening here.
plants don't necessarily work too well in indie shows, especially when it's people that the crowd are fairly familiar with, whether it's they've been wrestlers on the shows before or security or whatnot. So yeah, and like yourself, you instantly had known. You probably even noticed me as well. I won't even deny that was even discreet or the.
Probably did. I always like, if I'm looking at for folk in the crowd, because I like to just people watch, and sometimes it's more entertaining than sometimes what's in the ring. But when I'm seeing folk with masks, automatically I'm just going, right, child or wrestler? Child or wrestler? It's because it's going to be a child, generally, yeah, with masks. But was that during the whole Mr. New stuff, if I remember rightly?
It was. We were quite involved in that. In fact, it was, in the end, I think it was Mr. News. We had Claymore, LJT, and I think it was Scotty Rishu as well. So yeah, we were kind of brought in with the whole Mr. News angle as well, because that started just as I had started training, actually. So I was there to see it all. And then it was just quite interesting to be involved in that aspect as well. So
yeah, that angle is very interesting in general, especially when it led to things like the Hell for Lycra 11 that year. Was it that year? 14? No,
I think so, yeah.
Because my years are all over the place. But yeah, you end up getting Scott Rennick with you at some point as well.
I actually really enjoyed working with Scott Rennick, because he's one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet. And he kind of like took us, because we were all new, he kind of took us under his wing. And yeah, I really enjoyed it, because he was very good at like trying to keep us together, and just kind of, especially from my point of view, being quite young, he was able to like pass on a bit whatever knowledge he could to me. And I got the chance to like do tag matches with them as well. So it was good in that aspect. It's weird to think back. That was already 7 years ago. It's like, where has the time gone? Obviously, we've missed a year, but still.
I know, it's quite scary, especially like I was saying just before we hit records. I must saw you right at the start, and now I'm speaking to you, and it's, I think, oh, it must be a couple of years ago. And I'm looking at it going, yeah. No, it's no. Not. It's a lot longer than that, unfortunately. That must be a weird night, though, because somehow you end up in an interaction with Animal as well. Road Warrior Animal.
Yeah, that was fun at the time. And again, being the skinny guy of the group, they said, we're going to do the... Doomsday device. And he goes, just kind of looks around and clearly being the easiest choice, goes, you can take it. And I'm going, oh, okay. And then whatever happened, like there was a bit of a schmoz, and then everyone kind of left the ring, and I'm sitting on the outside going, I managed to get away with that. And then all of a sudden I just felt these hands just reach over the rope and grab my head. I went, nope. And got in, and I was fully expecting to go in the shoulders, but I just got kind of plonked, just like you would for the heart attack. Mm. And the guy that was coming off of the middle rope, his shoe broke as he jumped, and his foot went through the sole of the shoe, so he didn't get the greatest takeoff. And then I just felt this massive hand just land right on my chest. And I was like, oof. So, but yeah, again, 20 years old, and I get to say, yeah, I've done a segment with Animal. It's like, sure, I'll do that.
So it must be a pretty good first year then. From your perspective, 19, 20 years old, you've 4 months in and they're already putting you on shows. Of course, I suppose with hindsight and all that, like you say, you can look back and go, no, I shouldn't have done that at all. But, you know, you can told you can do it. Why not? Just do it. And then you're in the ring with Animal, which, I mean, at your point, 2006, when you started watching, he would have just been coming off his run with Heidenreich.
I think he had just finished up by that point, because I don't remember watching him when he was actively wrestling. So it was a big deal for everyone. And then, because they got to watch him growing up or something from the Ruthless, not the Ruthless Aggression, the Attitude Era on Raw, whereas I didn't get to see it. So it was, obviously I knew who he was because I'd watched things like going back. So, but it was, no, it was very, very interesting. It's the funny thing with wrestling is you can be watching these guys like on and performing massive venues, and then like a couple of years you're then actually like speaking to them or wrestling them or something. So and I even got the opportunity to wrestle guys like that who are like big names now. So yeah
again, it's the same as like yourself going to a show and meeting like a Viper or something at the time, and they're mm-hmm. just, you speak to them and they're all pleasant and that, and now she's just casually on Raw, just be at Baton yes. folks and looking and going, I met you at the Bonner Hall. This is weird. Yes. This is a very weird thing to happen. So you've had your interaction with Animal. You've had a couple matches at that point, mostly tags. How did you find by that point your in-ring work was? Or were you still kind of glad that you were in a tag team and you were on the job learning?
My ring work was sloppy. At the time I would have thought I was God's gift or something, because again I was being thrown into the mix. But when I say thrown into the mix, I was literally thrown in at the deep end, and I was trying to swim. It was either sink or swim, and that was me pretty much on the verge of drowning. And obviously, there was a lot of talent from Glasgow who were working for ICW and stuff like that. So there was a lot of people to contend with to get on shows. It wasn't an easy task, to say the least, but I do think, again, in hindsight, I wish I had a bit more time to develop, but yeah, it was still sloppy. But even then, at that point, I think I was still registering, like, I should be getting better, but I just wasn't getting a chance as much as I probably should have, like, working with people I could have learned a bit more from. But yeah,
I suppose your in-ring stuff at that point would have just been Brawl, and then you do a 450. Job's good. That's all it really needed to be at that point.
Yeah, it was because we were doing 6-man tags or something, or 8-man tags. There was lots of people to try and get in to do stuff in a match. So therefore, yeah, it was, you're the skinny guy, you get beat up at the start because you're the bad guy. But then you come in at the end and hit your big 450, and that therefore get the win. That was it.
So really, you're Seth Rollins of the Shield. That's the kind of, I mean, that, if you were told that at the time, that probably would have been even worse for your ego. But for your confidence, I should say.
I got told that all the time, that I was just a Shield tribute act. But I was like, yeah, fine, I'm just doing what I'm told.
Exactly. Well, I mean, I think the favorite one I got, because it was called the Trident, I think Mr. News just constantly called you Three Pricks, which, you know, made me laugh. But you're in that group anyway. So most of the time you're kind of just the bodyguards, the stoic three guys in black, definitely not the Shield at all. How did you find, like, did you have to learn your crowd interaction at that point? Because you're associated with, you're already going to get booed regardless. But did you find that getting the crowd interaction and working with the audience easy? Did you find it difficult? What was your kind of thoughts on that?
The Dundee crowd usually were quite good, and we were getting a lot of heat from the crowd anyway, so we didn't really have to do much. And just by association, we were already deemed as bad guys. So, and everyone, like all the fans, kind of knew who we were, what we were doing, and why we were there. So it wasn't difficult in the slightest. The Dundee crowds were genuinely good crowds, especially with that side of it. So yeah, it was, and that aspect, it was quite easy for us. And it was kind of a shame in a way, because we didn't really have to do much in terms of character development. So I ended up being just no charisma, no personality. I just had to go out there and just keep a straight face. That was basically it. That was all I told myself, because I was getting booed, and I didn't have to learn to try and get boos. That was it. So it took me a wee while to learn that.
So I kind of broke away from going down to shows after that event with Animal for whatever reason and what have you. But how, when that run ended with the Trident and you ended up on your own, were you told, how much advance notice were you given that this team's gone, you're on your own now, or were you just kind of told on the day, like, that's it, they're disbanding?
No, it was, part of me kind of asked if it was what was happening, because we started kind of dropping like flies. One of the guys got injured not long after that event, actually, and he was, I think he torn his ligament or something just snapped in his, like, in his leg, and he couldn't walk in it for months, so he was out of action. And then another, someone else got done something to their knee, and then it was just me and Scott Rennick. And it's like, we've gone from a team of three to a team of four, now we're down to two. And then they were doing this, I think at that point they also brought in a guy called St. George, who did not fit the kind of the gimmick that was there. So weird guys who are meant to be security guys, and here's a guy coming up waving an English flag, and it's like, doesn't suit. And then they did a European tournament, and they won at the Scotland-England final. And then Scott Rennick went off with that, and so did St. George. And I was like, oh, here I am. I was like, I just said, is there any possibility that I could try being a good guy, a face? Because you like, I'm doing a 450. And that's just kind of the, by that point, it was kind of just like the tip of the iceberg. It's like, I can do a lot more, but I'm working as a bad guy. I don't want to get cheered. So I'm not doing what I can do. So I asked, is it possible? I was like, yeah, we'll give it a go. And then that's how it kind of happened from there. There's one match, did the generic shake the hand at the end, and that's enough to make you a good guy now. Right at that point it was. So yeah, after that was just kind of how it happened. It was just piece by piece, and then the momentum was lost. So I thought, okay, we'll just try something different.
And then next month's hand claps and come on, guys.
Yeah, it's so easy that a guy's personality can change just like that.
But wrestling.
But it's so much more easier for me. I'm just naturally like, I'll just happily go out, clap my hands and stuff. Sounds weird, but yeah.
You're more comfortable just doing the cool moves and getting the cheers than just being a wronging and getting booed.
Just like, I'm quite happy just to do that. Let my moves get me over, and that'll be it.
So speaking of being a heel, though, you ended up in paid promotions. I can't remember what they changed themselves. I think it was Alpha Omega Wrestling. They ended up being as part of the referendum. Mm-hmm. So yeah, did you have a Scotland shirt handy and down the road you went?
I did. Yes, and that was very. It was just a case of they were needing someone to drive a car, and just so happened that I did have a car and I could drive. And so, do you have a Scotland shirt? It's like, yes. And it's like, that's fine, you'll do. it was very weird going down there. Because that was my first booking outside of Scotland. And I was doing, and I was kind of like trying to get away from the whole, at that point, I was trying to get away from being the bad guy. And it's like, okay, we need you to be a bad guy. And I was like, oh, okay. It's like, great. But thankfully, because it was Scotland gimmick and referendum in England, it was, you know, cheese on toast.
Oh, yeah.
So yeah. I was like, I can do that. That's fine.
I didn't have a note who you were with. I'm assuming it was Bobby Roberts because he seemed to be there all the time. And yeah, there was a bunch of them at some point. And Laird Grayson. It was a graphic came up, and it was just like loads of yous, just all standing in this graphic. So your singles career went well. I've just, as I said, I have noted bits and pieces here, but 2016 you won your first belt, the Future Division Championship.
Yes.
How excited are you, a belt guy? Were you excited to have a belt, or was it just another cool thing and that was it, or was it like
a belt? At the time, it was quite, I would say, special, because I was being given a chance to be a focal point for a promotion. And yeah, I mean, again, I know wrestling's all, it's like, it's, you know, it is what it is, but at the same time, I'm getting a belt. So, and again, at that point, what am I, 20, 21? It's like, yeah, still thinking it's cool for that. So yeah, I was quite chuffed when I found that I was going to get it. And I will I just thought it was a really nice looking belt. And I was going to keep it. And I'll tell you, that was the most well looked after anything of mine had ever been. Because, yeah, I kind of took pride in it as well, because it was nice belt. And I just kind of wanted to be like, oh, I'm a champion, so I'll act like a champion. But the first title reign didn't really last long.
was it the second reign you took it to Orlando?
Yes. So I won it back. I lost it in April, but I won it back in August. I lost it in May and I won it back in August. And I was going to WrestleMania, and my partner, she told me that they've got like these things, like things that you can see. So they've got cars driving about, and then in Universal Studios. And she's saying, well, there's like the train from Back to the Future 3. And she says, oh, they've actually got DeLorean as well. And I went, oh. And obviously the Future Division Championship was Back to the Future themed with the DeLorean on it and stuff like that. So I took it to Orlando with me to get a picture with the DeLorean and the belt. Which, if you've been to Universal or any of the theme parks over there, they've got quite tight security. So they've got like the metal detectors, and if you've got a bag, then you've got to put it through the X-ray machine and stuff like that. And I was like, this is going to look really weird that I'm taking this like 10 to 20 pound metal belt into a theme park with me, and I had to carry it in a rucksack, and it's not light. And then it was even funnier trying to get home, because the guy was in the airport was just looking at it, and it's like, what is this? And then he's just like throwing it in about, and it's like, that gets really looked after, please don't do that. But yeah, I thought, why not take it to Orlando. It's like, no one else is taking it. It's taking it there, so I'll stand out.
I think it's got a bigger claim of being a world title than anything else. If it means there. Being in Orlando, technically, yes. It's been worldwide. Yes. So when your partner suggested, or did she suggest that you take the belt, or were she like, they've got this Back to the Future stuff, and you're like, well, I could. And did you get a look of
that? You know? That's more accurate. It was kind of a light bulb moment. She says, oh, they've got this. And I went, oh, okay. Yes. And she kind of looked at me and went, no, you can't. And I was like, I can. And then I managed to convince her to do it. And I was like, true. If I was going to try and start messaging promotions to see like, oh, is there any possibility of wrestling on your show? And can I use this belt as well, and say, well, I've managed to defend it in America. But I thought, if I start taking away from this holiday, I mean, we're already going for WrestleMania, but we've booked a 3-week holiday off the back of it, so I've got to kind of stop the wrestling at one point. She's like, yeah, could you not? And I went, okay, under the thumb.
That's fair. It is a holiday for both of you at the end of the day, isn't it? Yes. You got your wrestling bit out of it. Yes. We're making discussions about going to WrestleMania and Hollywood, so not next year, year after. If it's two nights, my wife's already started like looking where Disneyland is in comparison to it, just because she's like, I'll do one night, I'm not doing two. Yeah. So I'll go to Harry Potter during the day while you're at that. Don't worry about it. So I don't think it'll happen, just because grown up stuff. I've got windows to buy, you know, exciting things. But that was the plan. If we're going anywhere, we need to find the nearest thing that she'll like. So if it's 2 days, she can just escape the second day, and that'll be it. But I couldn't imagine going about with like one of these things, these belts, about the whole time. Just for that reason, just people just judging it. And
you do get some looks, but then again, you're in a theme park, so anything's possible.
Well, in America, they've seen weirder than a guy going about with a belt. at the end of the day. So how was WrestleMania? What year was that? What year was WrestleMania? Was that?
It was 2017. It was good, but that's when I realized that WWE shows are really long, because I wanted to get there because I wanted to see the cruiserweight match with Neville and Austin Aries.
Oh, that is long. Out of
the whole show, that was the one I was really wanting to see the most. And it just so happened that was the first one on the pre-show. And we did get stuck in traffic. So we arrived there like and 30 minutes into the pre-show. And at that point, the pre-show was 2 hours. We eventually managed to find our seats. And then as soon as we got to the seats, I think it was Neville's music came on. And he came out and I was like, oh, right, okay. So it's first. And then I was like, well, that's the match I was really looking forward to. Obviously, like the rest of the show, it's WrestleMania after all, but I was like, that's the one I really wanted to see. It's like, okay. But we got there 30 minutes into the pre-show, and the main show then ran about 5.5 hours. And I was like, I was starting to feel like almost bad, because this was obviously meant to be a big night. Like, this was the night The Undertaker was to retire. And it's like, this is a man who's dedicated his career for so many years. And in my head, I'm like, I am knackered. I'm like, it's Orlando in the beginning of April, which is one of its hottest times of the year. So you're sitting in there getting like just baking sun just beating on you, and and then obviously, like, I think that was also the night the Hardys came back, and just like the rest of the crowd, I was going mental because I liked the Hardys. That obviously didn't see them in Attitude Era, but I liked what I watched because it was just cool. So I was jumping and shouting like a big fanboy that I was, because it was WrestleMania, why not? But I was knackered after that.
I'm just having a look at the card, and you would have had John Cena proposing to Nikki Bella. I bet that was fun.
Yeah, and my partner turned around to me and went, "Aw," and I went, it's like, okay. remember that time I was when you were going unconscious and I started speaking to you, and I was like, where's he going with this? That got a bit weird. However, I did get it to see that was just a bizarre segment in itself.
Randy Orton, Bray Wyatt in that weird thing. That was a WrestleMania and a half. Wow. What would have been weird though is the Andre the Giant Battle Royal. If I remember rightly, Killian Dane was in that for some random reason. So
yes,
you would have seen Demo.
Because I can't even remember if he was announced. It was just obvious they come out in bulk, and just all of a sudden like go to the ring, and I was like, I was just looking because we were at TakeOver the night before, and I was, so my partner knew who Killian Dane or Demo was, and then I was just looking, I was just kind of sitting there, and then I said, that's Demo, and I was like, that's a man that's beating me up in a ring, and he's now walking down the WrestleMania ramp. It's like, he beat me up with Hannibal. And my partner's like, what are you talking about? And I was like, oh wait, I forgot you weren't around at that point. It's like, and I had to explain to her the whole situation. She's like, yeah, that probably would have made more sense. But yeah, it's quite good to see like someone who was someone who worked his way up on the Scottish scene as well as the British scene, and managed to get to that point. It was quite, like, I thought again him performing at TakeOver was a good thing, but then to actually be named on a WrestleMania card, it's just surreal. And again, for a guy that I actually went to a couple of training sessions with in his school in Glasgow, to then Like, and he gave me some really good advice that I still take to this day. And then watching him go from that to being on WrestleMania, it was just surreal.
Just out of curiosity, because I don't think I've actually watched this whole WrestleMania, because I've seen the matches I wanted to see. That's pretty much how I went to see it. What was the Randy Orton Bray Wyatt match like with the whole projections?
The projections. It was weird. And there was a lot of confusion in the crowd. And you can kind of hear it when you watch the match back. It's just people are like, huh? Because it when I watched it the first time, it was kind of like a ew, because they had like worms in that on the projection. Then after two or three of them, I think everyone's just like, what? And then the third one was just a big groan. Like, oh, come on. It was that was the same time, that was the same entrance that Randy Orton had the snake walking him down to the ring.
Yeah.
Because I was in my head like, what? And it was clearly badly done, because it didn't even like, it looked like it was like lagging at certain points. I just kept laughing. I was like, I love the song, but like everything's just been taken away just from me watching the snake try and go down the ramp really badly.
Its head was too that, big.
Yes, that was it.
Use your imagination.
The match itself, yes. The match itself, it was, yeah. Whatever you read online is pretty much accurate. And then three holograms on the mat, and then all of a sudden an RKO out of nowhere. I mean, big pop because it was Randy Orton at the time, but yeah, it was not good.
So this podcast isn't about this event, but I do have one more question about it. Was you went to see Neville, and then the show actually kicked off with AJ Styles. So it's starting watching in 2006 and then going to see him in 2000 and whatever it was, 17, was it, you say?
Oh, I can't remember. Yeah,
17. So that's 10 years of wrestling you've been watching, and then you get to see AJ Styles wrestle at WrestleMania.
I was in my element, because watching the show back, I was really excited, because at that point he'd done a match with Jericho at Mania, but I was hoping that this would be the one that he would get his win. And AJ Styles, I had Batista, John Cena, but when I started watching TNA, and I think it was more 2007, 2008, that's when I started watching TNA a bit more religiously. AJ Styles was, without a shadow of a doubt, my favourite. So I watched him go from TNA to New Japan to WWE, and then I was getting a chance to watch him at WrestleMania. And yeah, I was just like a little fanboy. it was one of those ones, I wanted to see the Neville and Aries. It was on first. I wanted to watch Styles wrestle. He was on first, and I was like, I could in theory go home now, but I didn't know what to expect, because I was expecting, like, it was going to be a big name, like he had Jericho last year, and then he had Shane McMahon, and I was like, grown. And then I had low expectations. I was just excited to see AJ Styles. I had low expectations about the match, and the match was actually really fun to watch. So, and even my partner said, yeah, that was the best one of the night. So,
How much is your partner into the wrestling, or she just come along for the ride?
When I ask her, she still says that her favourite wrestler is me. And that's the stage she's at. Although she does have a crush on Bobby Roode and Randy Orton.
That's fair.
So, I was like, it's fine. Because we were at the takeover the night before, so I bought a Bobby Roode t-shirt, and she was chatting for him while I was chatting for Nakamura. So...
yeah, pretty much. That's my wife's, like, she'll come to the live shows, but she's not fussed for watching it on TV, which is unfortunate, because the one she has a crush on is Jack Jester, which I'm like, no, you can actually meet him. No, stop it. Fancy one's on the telly. Edge, yeah. Go for the Edge. That's fine. So we're coming back from that. No, it's the same year, I think. You're in the match with Kazuma Sakamoto. Watch me butcher his name.
That was. That was 2016, I think. I still have PTSD to that match because that was one of the first time I learned to wrestle. Well, I didn't learn to wrestle. I had to work a match in what was called strong style. Japanese wrestler who loves to chop. I didn't had no idea what I was expecting, but I learned a lesson that night, and that was, don't chop people, it's sore. I'm one of those ones is I'll only give it if I can take it, and after that night, no more chops. That was it. It was during a part of the match, he just kept chopping me, and you could easily see myself like hiding my chest, and he just shouts, "Open up!" And it's not on PG, but I told him basically to no. It was an over 18 show, so I was allowed to get away with that. But I looked down at one point, and I could see the blood dripping from my chest of where he broke the skin. And then after the match, because I didn't fake tan or anything, so I was quite. I don't tan well anyway, so I was very pale, and then just to have these red marks on my chest was, you know, they were clearly visible. It's like when Sheamus gets hit by like a kendo stick, it easily comes up. That's what my chest was like that night.
So I got Japanese told, wrestling, you like to watch than actual maybe partake in.
Yeah. Yes. Especially, yeah, when it's stuff like that. I'll just happily watch it from the sidelines and instead of participating. But I got a lot of good feedback that night, and it was because he'd wrestled for NXT FCW when it was that, and I got a chance to work someone of that level, and people generally said that it was probably one of the best matches on that night. And I was like, oh, okay, that's good. So I know I'm capable of having these matches, because even then I was developing, but I still wasn't like where I wanted to be for that length of time wrestling, compared to, again, maybe I set my expectations too high, but having that opportunity was quite good. I didn't know if I was getting an opportunity or I was being ribbed, and that's why I got chopped to death.
Speaking of opportunity though, you also were in that Fatal 4-Way in Perth with Ricochet. So it was yourself, Ricochet, LGT, and they're all Scotty Riccio. So yes. LGT, yeah. So Perth, this is when you first found out about Scottish wrestling in general. And now here you are in the ring with Ricochet, or as he liked, as he introduced himself to me, Trevor. Yes. Still the weirdest interaction I've had. But so what was it like in the ring with Ricochet then? Because you would be a bit more Ring of Honor, Japan. I don't think he would have been. He wasn't TNA, so did you know much of Ricochet before you saw him?
I at that point I did, because when I started training, I think in about 2012, that's when I started opening up to a bit more of the, like, outside of the TNA WWE bubble, and I started seeing what's going on, especially when I started training, because I wanted to see more of what was happening. So I knew who Ricochet was, and I'd seen like loads of videos on YouTube and that, so and I was really excited to do it, but I wasn't actually even meant to be in the match originally. I wasn't even, because I got told who was going to be in the match, and I kind of like, it's Perth, it's my hometown, it's Ricochet, I was a high flyer, it's like the stars have aligned, and I got told who was in the match, and I just kind of went, oh, okay, and I was pretty bummed, but then things changed and I got the opportunity. I was like, great, I'm gonna take it. And it was, again, hometown. I was at the college, that's where I studied, and it was like, I had a lot of friends and family who were wanting to see me, and sometimes just because of the way things worked, they never got a chance to go through to Dundee. I was like, I'm now physically coming to you guys, and they made the effort to come out, and again, they were getting to see Ricochet, or Trevor. That man doesn't look like a Trevor.
But it's just, yeah, he's so casual about it. Hi, I'm Trevor. It's like, what are you
doing? Yeah.
Cool.
And I got to, I was the one that went and got him from, I think he was in Edinburgh the night before, so I was the one that was kind of chauffeuring about that day. And I got to speak to him, and that it was really good. And it was just interesting because for as much as we had foreign talent on our shows, I never got a chance to speak to them like on a one-to-one basis, whereas he was in the car with me. He had to put up with me regardless. So, but he was a nice guy, and just it was good to speak to him before and then go and have a match with him, because the guy's just unreal before he does in the ring.
Absolutely. He's definitely a guy whose style is definitely something you've either picked up from, or there's definitely similarities. So I can't say that word.
But you know, try to replicate a couple of things here and there. Some went well, some didn't.
But I'm not going to go for the jump. Was it the 450 over the top rope and land on your feet?
I don't think that'll be on the cards anytime soon. I think one person that can do that's enough in the world.
I know. I think they even tried to do it again with Dexter Lumis, and they edited it so badly that it was very clear that he didn't do it on NXT a couple of years
I've
back.
I've missed that.
I'm sure if you search up, you can very clearly see it. They've edited it so badly that it's just clear he didn't do it. But yeah, that's a story for another time. So that was your 2016. And then you went to WrestleMania and showed off your belt. And then your 2017 got even better because you were in the ring with Davey Boy Smith Jr., Harry Smith, DH Smith, whatever you want to call him.
Yeah, that was a kind of out of the blue thing as well, because it was just kind of, I think it was the day before the show, I was like, all right, okay, sure. And again, I knew who he was because I watched him in WWE and knew what he was doing in New Japan and stuff like that. And I think he was out of New Japan at that point, but he was just going back over. And then it was just a completely different style, because I think at that point I was a bad guy again. I was like, one thing I've noticed in wrestling, especially in Scottish wrestling, is a lot of people are quite, it's the average height is a lot smaller than the average height of American wrestlers. And then all, like for me, I'm deemed that if I wear boots, I'm deemed a tall guy. And then I'm working Davey Boy Smith Jr., who's about 6'6", 285 pounds. And I'm like, I am not ready for this. And this is a guy who at that point was starting to do shoot wrestling. I was like, okay. So, but again, every time I got a chance like that, it was always a learning experience. Even if I made a mistake, I was just always taking in a bit of feedback. But from what I gather, he said everything, he was quite happy with what I was doing. So I took that as a positive, because even when people are being like really nice about it, I'm like, yeah, there must be something, because I'm always looking for something to work on. But he didn't have anything to say about it, so it was all good.
That's the weird thing you said about him just being like 6'6", humongous. It doesn't really do it justice when you watch on TV the size of these guys, because my example is always Chavo Guerrero, who looks tiny in the ring.
Yeah.
And then you meet him, and he's my height and about an extra foot either side of me, because he's just so broad. And I'm like going, you're a cruiserweight. This doesn't compute. This doesn't make sense to me that you're a cruiserweight and you're humongous as well.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Because generally in WWE, they were all big guys, so you couldn't tell them apart. Whereas you put a tall guy like one of them in like our kind of ring, it's like, yeah, they're a lot bigger now.
So you had that one, yeah, the Stu Hart Heritage Championship that unfortunately didn't pick up. And then that year you were supposed to face Zack Sabre Jr. at the Carrot Hall.
Yes.
Which didn't happen. But when you found out that you were going to be, at the time, you were going to be in the ring with Zack Sabre, and you were SWE of course, myself has done that. SW, you're a heavyweight champion of the Dundee promotion at that point. And so you're going to go in, defend the title against Zack Sabre Jr. When you find that out, was it just mind blown? Was it butterflies? What was your emotions finding that
I
out?
I was really, really looking forward to it because I thought I was doing really well. That I was like, oh, I could have something interesting. And this was a guy that at the time he was wrestling all over the UK. So if I do really well, where does that put me in the aspect? Like, is this a guy that can say, oh, check this guy out or something? So in my head, I was like, all the possibilities off the back of it. And again, wrestling for it's a heavyweight belt. It's in the care at all, like British style wrestling. I was like, it's a big deal. And then I imagine you'll be mentioning the fact that it didn't go ahead.
No, you're in the ring with Saxon Huxley instead, one of the standouts from the UK tournament, apparently.
So I liked Saxon. Nice guy. It was just obviously I was doing a lot of watching Sabre matches because I was trying to see what I could do. And I wasn't prepared. At that point I don't even think I was enjoying wrestling as much as I was. And then the Zack Sabre Jr. thing was kind of giving me the, like, it was a boost, and then it was like the rug was just taken away from me, and I was like, I'm back to square one again. Okay. But yeah, and then I went out and just tried to do as much as I can. It was quite clunky in that aspect. Because he was a big guy, like quite ripped as well, but he was working as a face, and here's me, like a lot smaller than him, not as muscly, and I'm playing the big guy that's trying to beat up on him. I was like, it just didn't work, and I felt uncomfortable in that aspect of it as well. So, yeah.
But you finally got your match with him, with Zack Sabre Jr. the year after. Must be the start of the year because it was a rumble, so that's usually the start of the year.
Yeah.
Were you more hyped for that because it was actually happening, or was it just at that point you said you weren't enjoying wrestling particularly at that time? Was it just like this is cool, this is happening now, but I'm not going to enjoy it as much as I
was. I was excited for it because it was something that I was looking forward to before. And the part of me is like, am I still going to get it? Am I not? You know, and then to still get the opportunity to do it was great. And I really enjoyed doing the match. I'm not going to lie, I was 100% nervous because at that point, I think this was on his rise in Japan. I think a couple of weeks after the show he had done, he went on to win the New Japan Cup. Not that I'm taking credit for him going off and doing that, but I was just the warm-up to it, I suppose. But no, I was really looking forward to it. And at that point, the crowd were like, Zack Sabre Jr. was like the top independent wrestler in the world at that point. And like I said, the Dundee crowds can be quite good, but that night they were like, at that point I was a good guy, I was a face, but there was not a chance in hell that I was going to get any chance for myself. They were all they wanted to see Zack Sabre Jr. And I think that's what, as for as much as they were wanting to see him, I just fed off that because I was like, well, I'm going to prove that you kind of want to see me too. I've watched it back, and again, still enjoyed what we did in the match. Again, I'm my own worst critic, and there's some things that would have gone, yeah, I could have done better, but at the time, nah. I was on a high at that point.
So not long after that, you kind of took a break away from Dundee, and you were popping up in Reckless Tent. In between that, you were in United Pro Wrestling, which possibly, mm-hmm. I'm sure you came up to Bucky at some point, and that's when I would have seen you again. So it would have been weird. The last time we'd have seen you actually wrestle live would have been that you've been getting slapped by John the Bomb with Animal, and then next time we'd have seen you is in Bucky years later. So many years later. Yeah. So that would be what, three, four years, three-ish. Yeah. So, but UPW is kind of the same thing as the Dundee firm coming up here. Yeah. So, all right, though. So, what made you decide to shift your focus to Reckless Intent?
I was always interested in going to Reckless Intent. And I just, I don't know if it was just myself that kept talking about it. And to be fair, like you said, I took time off. I contemplated just stopping because I'd lost all like passion for wrestling, and I didn't enjoy it. And so I did, my last show that I did in 2018 was, I think, the start of September. And then I said, I'll take the rest of the year off, not do any shows, and then I'll see how I feel at the end of the year. And even at the end of the year, I was still kind of like, I'm not into it. But at the same time, my granddad passed away, and he was quite a big supporter of my wrestling. And I think the last one he was at was, I think it was the last show I did in Dundee in the Care at All. And then he was ill after that. But 8 days after my granddad passed away, my partner's Nana passed away as well. So we had a lot of stuff going on in the house, going on in the families. And I just needed something to kind of take my mind off of things. And at that point, Alex Webb said he was training at Reckless. And it was myself and Grum, because we were the Perth crew that always went to Dundee, and he was going through to Livingston for Reckless, and I went, can I come? And that's a joint, like, and then I just started there, and then I started getting back into the swing of it. And the guys at Reckless were just, they were really sound. And you were just able to talk to them. And I just got on with everybody there. I didn't have to worry about any politicking. I just went in, spoke to some mates, did some training, and I got to go home. And then eventually, I think they did a Sunday slam for the Battle of West Lothian. And they said, do you want to be on the show? And I was like, yeah, absolutely, I'll give it a go. And I got to wrestle Theodorus. I think that was the first time I'd been on the same shows as him for like 4 years prior or whatever it was, I'd never actually wrestled him. And it was just good to work with someone new, because I felt like I was wrestling the same people constantly, whereas now I was getting, it was more of a challenge. And I think that's what sparked the passion again, was I'm challenging myself to work different people, different styles and stuff. So that's how it kind of all came about, was just people that I'd known that were going, and then one thing led to another, and I've started working a bit more regularly now.
Well, you mentioned Alex Webb, which seems to be the perfect segue for the Fair City Saints. We do have a couple of questions coming in. They're both the same. But I'll read them both out. I'm sure you've read them already. We've got Alistair Caron asking, I'm sure I've said that wrong, it's probably Caron or something. How long does he make his son Alex Webb sit on the naughty step when he loses a match? And Deacon Matthews has asked, is it true Alex Webb is your son? So
how long? It's not necessarily how long, it depends on which step. If it's really bad, I make him sit and step outside. And if it's not as bad, I let him sit and step inside. It seems to be a running joke that my illegitimate son, because, like I said at the start, I look a lot older than what I am. Like every time someone says like play the guess the age name. Everyone gets me wrong, and it can be like quite a significant amount of number, like years, to the point that it can almost cause an offence. But I'm okay with it now because I'm just used to it. But Webb is, he's only like 4 years younger than me, but because I act so much older or look so much older, people just assume that. I say, oh, he's old enough to be your dad. And I'm like, we're in the same decade. We're born in the same decade. But it just so happens. And even like the tag team stuff, it was just by chance because at the time, Reckless, they didn't have a lot of tag teams when we started. There was a lot of single stuff going on at the time. And they said, oh, we don't really have a lot of like space on the cards for you. It's like, but we're thinking of putting you in a tag team with Webb. And I was like, I always wanted to be a tag team wrestler. That's when I, like I said, I wanted to come in as a tag team, but I never found the right person. But I thought, well, this is someone who I know, I've trained with, we're from the same area, so why not? And so that's how it came about. And we've all of a sudden now created this dynamic that I'm really old, but he's really young. I don't know how it's happened, but maybe it's just the way that I am.
To be fair, Alex does look 12. So you could be the age that you actually are, and he looks way younger than he should be.
It's funny because he tries to grow facial hair. I mean, no, we keep telling him he's trying too hard, but it's just the way it is. It's like it can't be undone, unfortunately. So we've just committed to it.
It's fine. There's other father and son teams about. There's at the moment, I don't know if you've seen Crusher Crave and Connor Malloy up in WrestleZone. They're now just called by other people, not actual official, but Crusher and his son, because Connor's really tiny and Crusher's obviously humongous. So it's, yeah. So maybe one day a father and son tag team between the two of you, that'll just battle out. But yeah, so the team itself, though, you said it was by chance you were kind of thrown in with Alex, and that was you as a team. So initially you were just called Myles and Webb. Who came up? I think I may have asked Alex when I interviewed him, but who came up with the name of Fair City Saints?
Not to take the full credit, I think it was me. Just because the Myles and Webb thing was more kind of just like, oh, Edge and Christian. But I was like, it could be something more to it. And we were both big punk fans. And I remember they were called him and Colt Cabana were called the Second City Saints. And then I was like, well, we're from Perth. It's the Fair City. And even then, the football team is called St. Johnston or the Saints. I was like, it's a no-brainer. So I just went, why don't we just... I can't even remember if I'd asked him first or if it was just by chance on a show, they said, have you got a tag team? And I just said, oh, that's what we're called. And he was, but I just thought, we'll try something different, and seems to have stuck.
I think from what I remember, that was pretty much his story as well, that you just came up with the name and he was like, yeah. Yeah, we'll go with that. That's fine.
He was happy to go along with it. But yeah, that's how that came about.
So going through something, obviously did a lot of tag stuff at Reckless, but one match that really popped out was your stuff in Source, and you ended up in the tag team tournament, which got suspended because of, you know, COVID.
COVID.
But you were in the opening round against More Than Hype, which is a pretty big team in Ireland, and they were starting to really pop up in the UK, and then of course COVID. So what was it like in the ring with Webb at first and trying to work that through, and then get in the ring with More Than Hype?
It was really good because like you say, they were an up-and-coming team and they were getting booked on various promotions, so we were quite excited going into it. The fact that we were the team that was getting put into this match in the first place was good, and again kicking off the tournament and stuff, we were really looking forward to it. And Webb is quite energetic in the sense that he likes to do a lot of stuff because he can. I'm very more reserved. And I think that's one of the reasons why our tag team work is like we kind of counteract each other. Mm. And it's like he wants to do loads. And I was like, no, we should. And it's like, calm down. I'll try and bring him down to my level, but he'll try and bring me up to his. And then we kind of compromise and meet in the middle. And then we're in hype again, see what those guys do in OTT. I was like, I've got my work cut out for me. Because they'll do more of what Webb wants to do. And I was like, okay. And then we turned up to the show in Govan, which was an experience.
Yeah.
I've done Glasgow shows, but there's Glasgow shows and there's Govan shows. And Govan is hostile. And we didn't really think about it, but we had orange gear. And then I got told about the whole you know, Celtic Rangers thing, and I went, which colour am I allowed to wear here? But because More Than Hype were the first ones came out and they had this really upbeat music, Webb and I came out and we just could, there was nothing that we could have done, and we were still trying to act as good guys as well as More Than Hype. I was like, we should just give up. We should just start just going, being dicks and just start like, yeah, just beating them up. And it's like, no, we'll keep going. But yeah, it was, the match itself was really good. It was quite crisp. And yeah, it was just the crowd that we were more afraid of than them.
Yeah, I think that was the one they uploaded. Because I mind watching it because the Govan crowd, I've only seen one show of one source, one on YouTube. And it still haunted me because they're just so rock and they were just so horrible. But like to the wrestlers, like not horrible as in silent. They were just, you had to have thick skin if you're wrestling in Govan. That was it. I don't know if you were subject to any particular chants, but I don't know if you're on the same show. I think it might be the same one with Athena and Samory Taylor and stuff like that, who just got absolutely ruined.
I've heard of it. I wasn't on that show, but I've heard of it. So
experience. That's probably the best way to sum it up as. So Reckless Intent, just working your way there, of course, and then you made your Discovery. I've got debut. I hope I'm not wrong. Discovery debut. Discovery in 2020, just before the world ended.
Yes.
What was it like? So your first interaction in wrestling in front of a crowd was beating up Mr. News, and now you're turning up in Discovery, which is co-ran by Alan Smith, aka Mr. News. So had Alan always kind of kept tabs on yourself through Reckless and what have you, and brought you in, or how did you end up in Discovery?
So for a while I was messaging Discovery trying to see if I could get a booking on or a chance to go on the shows, and obviously Reckless Intent work a lot with Discovery, with likes of setup and stuff like that. So when I got the chance to start training working with Reckless, I then started working helping out with Discovery, and that's when I got to speak to Alan on a personal one-to-one basis, and then we got the opportunity. There was their show all about the raffle, and on that they had a battle royal where everyone in the battle royal was given a ticket for a member of the audience, and whoever won, the audience member would get a prize. and it was really good because it was a promotion that I think it's one of the top promotions in Scotland, without a shadow of a doubt, and it was somewhere that I'd watched from when they were starting out. Like, I remember going to, I didn't go to the first one, but I was at their second and their third one, and I was watching it from like a fan's perspective. But then to actually perform was just, it was surreal. And like, for as much as it was about a royal, it was still a good chance because I think I was in the final two. So I did manage to get a chance to to show a bit of my stuff as well. And then that actually paid off, because I think some people remembered me from when I was wrestling in Dundee, who were fans that came to Discovery, or fans that were from Reckless that then got to see me at Discovery. They were able to remember who I was. Didn't get a big pop off. There was a couple of people going, "Oh, I know him." So
that's the thing. Like I was saying with the UPW stuff, it was just so weird seeing like yourself and Ian Ambrose, guys that I remember watching when I went when I made the trip down to Dundee, and then I stopped making it, and I didn't get to see you guys at all wrestle, just online. And then to see you come out, I'm like, "Ah, nice wee treat. I know who this guy is." The kids are just going mental because, you know, it's wrestling. They just want to see wrestling. Yeah. And I'm just going, "Well, you're in for a treat. I know who this guy's like. It's fine. It's good time." But yeah, it's weird when you go out and there's a new crowd, but there's always a pocket that's just like, "Yes, and this is going to be ace because I know who this person is." There's always a pocket of 2-3, lack of a better word, marks that know everything, that come out and know everyone that comes out that'll have the wee pop. But then, so Discovery, make your debut, all looking well, COVID. And that's it. That's the end of the year. So 2020 is over. So how did you end up filling your time? I mean, you did say beforehand you end up working from home, much like myself. So is that pretty much been it since
And it was weird. I did start working from home, and then there was a period during it that I just decided I'm going to do, regardless of what else I do in the day, I'm just going to do 100 press ups and 100 sit ups. I just started doing random stuff like that, because I wasn't at the start. I obviously wasn't allowed to leave the house and stuff like that. So I just then decided I'm going to do that. I'm just going to try and do stuff in the house, try and do home workouts. Because one thing that we haven't mentioned during the timeline is the weight gain that I got was I went from being in 2014 about 11 stone. My heaviest at the start of 2020, I was 16 stone 2. So I did let myself go. And then during 2020, I managed to get back down to 14.4. So I then, that was mainly it. I was just trying to, I just stopped drinking fizzy juice. I just tried to be a bit healthier and just kind of keep myself sane. I started playing Call of Duty more. I had my partner, stepbrother, he's mad about it. So I got a wireless gaming headset, paid for a PlayStation Plus subscription, and started playing Call of Duty. The big battle royale thing that they basically copied the Fortnite.
Warzone. I play Fortnite, so
I started playing Warzone, and that was basically it. And even during like the summer when it was like baking hot and my PlayStation was overheating because of the memory that this game had consumed, it was absolutely horrendous because the fan on my PlayStation was nearly going to give in. But then we got teased that we were going to come out, so I started doing a bit more sociable things and going out, like walking and running, and then they kind of shut the doors again in 2021. So I think my New Year's resolution at that point was just to do 2 hours of running a week, and I managed to keep that up for 3 or 4 months, and I managed to drop down to 13.10. So I managed to get myself in a bit better shape and be a bit more wrestling shaped. So yeah, that was my lockdown. I was trying to lose the weight I put on with wrestling.
I mean, I didn't mention it because I have no right to comment on it anyway, because I'm tipping 19 now, and I started lockdown at about 16 and a half. So you don't realize how much, like for me, I didn't do a lot. I've got a dog, so I would take her out. But generally, my exercise would be a 10-minute walk to work, a 10-minute walk home. I don't have that anymore because I work here and my bedroom's there. So you don't realize how that 20 minutes out of your daily routine is impacts you so much. I think I've been told that once the fizzy juice is out of the fridge and drank, that's it. That's it gone for who knows how long. So that's I found that was the easiest thing. It was not even the exercise, just took out the fizziness. Then it just dropped off. So that's the hope and plan for the next couple of months anyway. Which is a shame because Christmas time. It's gonna be a very small turkey. So you had that trying to keep going. Did you fall into the trap? Because again, before we hit record, I was admiring your shelf behind you. Did you fall in the trap of everyone else where you couldn't do anything? You just end up buying toys. Because that's what I did.
I kind of did, but I collect pop vinyls. I even got called a monster because I take them out of the box. But the ones I collect, like the Marvel ones that I collect, are bobbleheads, and I wanted their heads to bobble, so they had to come out of the box. But one thing, my mum was clearing out her house and trying to get rid of stuff that I had left when I moved out, and she found an old box of Lego. And I was watching a Star Wars, and I seen Slade one that Jango Fett had, and I remembered that. Oh, I got that when I was a kid. I'm sure it's all the pieces are in the box. So I started reading through it, and I managed to get the old instructions off of the Lego website, and I built it. But then I also remembered that my gran bought me stuff from the Phantom Menace. Anakin's pod racer, and the Naboo
Yes, I know of it, yeah.
Starfighter. She'd bought me that when I was like 5 or 6, and I was like, oh, I'm sure the bits are all there as well. And then that's the trap I fell into. I bought Lego,
Oh, it's an expensive trap to
and
get
it's
into.
not even it is and it was I learned that the hard way, because my mum then bought me one for my birthday, which was the Avengers Helicarrier. And I was like, oh no, because I have got quite an addictive personality. That's how the pop vinyl started. I bought one Rey Mysterio pop out of a Forbidden Planet in Aberdeen just by chance, and now I have 120. It's the same with Lego, because I look at them like, oh, but there's a whole collection. Oh, I must have it. So yeah, I've spent. But I wasn't spending on anything else. So that was my way of justifying it. It's like, I can't do anything else. I may as well build Lego.
That's my thing as well, because yeah, I wasn't going anywhere. If anyone watches the first couple of episodes of this podcast, I have four pops and they're all out of the box, and that's it. That's all I've got. And now I've got, I think there's about 40 around about this room somewhere. And it was, well, mine was more the case of I went onto Facebook Marketplace, which is always dangerous anyway, and someone was selling them for like £7 a piece, and there was like 10 of them. I was like, bargain, I'll have all of them. And then they put up on our lot next week, and I was like, oh, great, I'll get them as well. And here we are. And it's just expanded. I mean, the belts were already there, but I was able to take them out of the loft when lockdown happened so I could make the background look funky for the Zoom calls. That was the excuse I used for it. And I've gotten away with it since. But no, it's an expensive hobby. You mentioned, I mean, Star Wars, I don't mind, it's not really my thing, but Avengers is, so I'm all in for Avengers talk. So when this goes out, still haven't got Spider-Man, so that's okay.
Oh, it's I'm really looking forward to it. I know Webb is, because he's obviously a massive Tobey Maguire fan, and I did like them. I do like the Tom Holland ones, and Andrew Garfield's ones were all right, but I really like Doctor Strange. It's very odd that he's probably one of my favorites. I just like Benedict Cumberbatch, and I just find the way that he just portrays him is just really good. It's just dry, but like Infinity War, it's just like the quick wit that he has when they're on the planet on Titan and stuff. So yeah, how that'll play out will be very interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I went to see Eternals last weekend as a recording, and I didn't enjoy it, and I didn't enjoy the film. I just turned to Kelly afterwards and went, you know what, if it wasn't Spider-Man next, then I would have been soured on Marvel, but no, it's Spider-Man next, and Spider-Man's amazing, so it doesn't matter what's happening.
I wasn't a big fan of Eternals either, but Shang-Chi was actually quite good.
Oh, well, I went in there with low expectations because I didn't know the character. Same with Guardians. And I came out going, that was bloody amazing. That was a great film. And then I went in the same with Eternals and it kind of stayed. My level of intrigue about them was just...
I don't know if it was maybe the cast that maybe hyped up too much, because there was quite a few names that I recognised, whereas I wasn't as familiar with some of the ones in Shang-Chi. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's why that one... So that's because, again, expectations are that a little bit lower.
Yeah. I mean, I'll see a sequel. It was enough to get me to see a sequel, but yeah, the film itself was 2.5 hours and it was too long.
Yeah. I started playing the Marvel's Avengers game again. I bought it last year and then I started playing it again, and then Alex decided to release a video on how crap it is, and I went, oh, thanks. It's like, I've just got the DLC, man. I was like, but I was watching his video and went, it's justified.
I started it because I think they did a weekend where they put out it for free and you got to play the whole weekend. So I played a couple hours of it and I was just like, this isn't fun for me. I think it's because they were so, it was like was it like Westworld? I've never seen Westworld, but I think it's the right reference. But it was like Westworld versions of these characters where they looked kind of like the characters in the movie, but not enough. So it just looked weird. And I was going, no, I'm just not enjoying this at all. I'll play Lego Marvel instead. That's more fun for me.
I started doing that and I completed them both. Got all the characters.
Oh, including the first Lego Marvel superheroes, because if you have, I hate you, because the races are just awful. Just can't work them.
I'm not going to lie, they weren't easy. I think it was is it Captain Britain, that one in particular, or his mini. It was very difficult to try and get, but it's weird that you think it's very difficult in a Lego game, but it's like, trust me, it really is.
Oh yeah, it's the Silver Surfer one that I gave up. I was just like, nah, it's not worth it anymore. This isn't worth this little platinum trophy popping up in my corner of my screen. This is it. I'm done. So we're playing Avengers just now because my wife loves Lego games, and Lego Avengers are all just perfect. But no, it's, Lego games is my jam. And that's why I play, I've got Fortnite and I've got Captain America. Unlock all these characters as I go along. It's like, nope, I'm Captain America. I've got my vibranium shield. It's all I need in this game. Whatever. Anyway, this will turn into a Marvel. Who's your favorite? So Doctor Strange said you're your favorite. Is there any other your favorite superheroes of all time?
I would say Spider-Man's certainly up there, because I used to watch the animated cartoon on, at the time it used to be called Fox Kids, and they re-released it on Disney Plus, so I watched it all again. And my partner was like, are you really watching a Spider-Man cartoon? I went, yes, absolutely. There's not a shadow of a doubt. Drax by default, purely because it's Batista.
Of course.
Iron Man just because it's Iron Man. Just can't be touched. And Thor. Thor after Ragnarok is just absolutely amazing.
Mm-hmm.
It's
so weird. I didn't go see Thor and I didn't see Ragnarok in the cinema because I didn't like Thor. I mean, they're not my favorites, but Thor 1 and The Dark World, just they weren't good films in the early years. So I was like, I'm not gonna go see a third Thor film, and then it turns out it's like my fourth favorite Marvel film ever. And I was just saw it in the cinema.
I didn't know what to expect. And I've seen the trailer, but it had a different vibe to it. And then I watched it and I was like, I absolutely love this. Because, I rate it as probably one of my favourites. Because it's just... I love comedy. Like, Like, I'll quite happily just watch stand-up comedy movies. I just like to laugh. And it's a very bad thing, especially when I'm in a serious situation and I just can't stop laughing. But I think that's why I like Marvel movies, is especially like sort of Thor or Guardians of the Galaxy or anything like that, is they're very funny. So yeah, that Ragnarok just stood out there. And it's probably why they say, what's better, Infinity War or Endgame? I'll probably see Infinity War, because there's just a lot more one-liners in there that just kill me, because it's, yeah.
It's a very fine line. I think I've got Endgame just above it, just for portals, the portal scene alone, and the whole lifting of Mjolnir and all that stuff. It's just
I could maybe trump that. Well, maybe Thor arriving in Wakanda. That's still pretty good. They're the two scenes that kind of fight with each other for me.
Yes, I mean, yeah, for me they're top two, for just because of the whole epicness of it, and then afterwards it's quite a close race for like Thor Ragnarok, and because I'm a big Spider-Man fan, I'd have Homecoming in there as well, and all that kind of stuff, just Spider-Man, and going back and watching the old ones in preparation of the Way Home, and there's some ropey CGI which I don't think Alex would appreciate me mocking, but it's a tough watch, some of them. It's just a shame that the proper best one is the only one that's not on Netflix, Spider-Man 2, which ridiculous. It's got all the rest of them, but not Spider-Man 2.
That was actually the first one I watched. I've got this terrible habit of watching the sequel before I watch the original. Even with like Iron Man 2, I seen that first before Iron Man. And I was like, even though Iron Man is clearly the better one, it just so happened it was on the telly. But Spider-Man 2, because again, at that point, I was maybe 2004, did it come out? So I was 10. So it just happened I wasn't old enough to like go to cinemas or stuff like that. So my mum bought it as part of, before the days of subscriptions to streaming services, you used to get a subscription to a DVD that used to arrive at your door. And it just so and just so happened one of them was Spider-Man 2. I think it was the days, but like I think it was called Love Film.
Oh, of course, yeah, Love Film. Remember that?
So that, and that's how I got like Pirates of the Caribbean, Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers. All those movies were because of this sort of service, and Spider-Man 2 was one that I got as well. So I watched Spider-Man 2, and then I watched Spider-Man 1. And then I watched Spider-Man 3, and I won't comment because I don't want to upset Web.
Yeah, I watched it. I mean, Topher Grace is good in that 70s show. Maybe that's where he should have stayed. Anyway, so we'll go back to wrestling for a minute, because I'm just looking at the time and I'm thinking, geez, it's fair past, and I didn't realise how quick it was going. Back to wrestling for a second then. So you've had this time, you got back finally wrestling for the Return of the Discovery show and the their tag team tournament against the 9-9, wasn't it, you're against? Yep. So what was it like getting in front of a crowd again?
It was very, very bizarre, because again, this is something like my longest period like was maybe 3, maybe 4 months. We were talking 20 months at this point. And the whole way leading up to it, I was going, I'm feeling okay. Webb was like, oh man, I'm nervous. I was sitting there going, no, I'm doing all right. And then about 5 minutes before I go through the curtain, that's when it set. Then I was like, oh God, this is it. And I'm like, and again, it's Discovery. It was a sold out show. There was, I can't remember the amount of people, but there was a lot. It was the biggest crowd I'd worked in front of for a long time, never mind for my first show back. So it was very bizarre, but it was good that it was them, because they were very good, and they were just really excited to watch wrestling again, which I can understand after such a long time. But yeah, I really enjoyed that. It was kind of, again, you do that kind of, you've been off it for so such a long time, like 20 months without wrestling. And then you kind of think, oh, could I walk away? Could I not? But then that kind of reignites the passion that I had. So, yeah.
Yeah, I knew myself just as a fan going to a show, and I was like, I didn't realize how much I missed going to see wrestling until it happened. I was like, oh, just overcome with emotion. Wife turned around going, are you crying? Like, no, I'm not crying. Crying at all. Shut up. So now that you're back in the ring, you've got Webb by your side, like your son. Is there any place you want to get to now? Now you're back wrestling. Whether it's here, England, anywhere. Is there any promotions or opponents you even want to get in the ring with?
I would like to start wrestling with as a tag team. Fair City Saints. I'd like to start getting a lot more regular bookings, not necessarily particular places, but just getting it like week in, week out, just constantly having matches. Again, there's big companies like WrestleZone, be very interested in working with them. If I can get into like sort of keep getting on the Discovery shows as well, that would be really good. I'd like to start breaking out into England a lot more, and then hopefully try and get like overseas. One of my goals would be is I'd like to do a tour of, or like just work abroad, whether it be Japan or even Mexico. I don't know if I'd be able to keep up with the luchadors or if the Japanese would just beat me up, but one of the two would just be really, it would just be good to say that I've done it. I mean, the ultimate goal would be your big promotions, WWE, AEW, but obviously that's the long-term goal. But just now, just kind of getting more bookings in the UK, just kind of build up a bit of a reputation of being quite a good tag team.
That's right, yeah. And of course, with Alex kind of leaning away with the whole YouTube stuff as well, there's definitely more eyes on him in turn, which also puts more eyes on you as a team together. I don't think he did a watch along with one of his pals recently and on YouTube, and I don't think he's put any Fair City Saints matches in there, but there were some matches in there that maybe he wanted to forget and somehow have come back. And I don't know if you're watching thinking, please don't put any of ours in. Don't put any of ours in here, just in case.
Funnily enough, he did say that he did mention it to myself and others that he was going to do it. And we offered to do the watch along with him. And he said, oh yeah, that'd be a great idea. And he obviously got out of the car, thought about it and went, that's a terrible idea. They'll rip me to shreds. And then he got his friend who didn't watch wrestling. And I went, you were too scared, weren't you? He's like, pretty much. I was like, I need to put that on YouTube. You guys would have just demolished me. So,
I mean, his mate did a pretty good job of doing that.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah, he did it himself, but yeah, we would have done it for him. That's what friends are for.
Absolutely. So we've got two questions that we ask everyone, which I thought I was going to forget, but just popped into my head. Two ridiculous non-wrestling related questions we ask everyone. First one being, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Dinosaur? I'm just going to say T-Rex.
And assuming because of your amazing Buzz Lightyear in the background, it would be Rex, the dinosaur, as well.
Yes. Exactly.
The other question we ask everyone is, what would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
I'd say two sheep, because they can gang up on the cow.
That's my answer. And anyone who says cow is wrong. But that's my answer. It's just the teamwork. And the final thing, before we do the whole social medias and all that kind of stuff, and then we'll go our separate ways, I'm trying to make this the last question. When Fancy Book, you've been given the last match, main event, WrestleMania. Who's your opponent?
I would say Seth Rollins.
Well, this has been again, when I came into these chats, I'm like, oh, we've got a couple notes. It'll be about an hour, give or take. We'll be fine. And here we are, hour and a half later. And I think we could have went longer if we kept speaking about Marvel for more length of time. But where can people find you on social media if they want to see more about the Fair City Saints or about Air Myles?
Yeah. So you can follow me on, you can get me on Facebook. You can like my page, Air Myles hyphen pro wrestler. Just in case anyone gets confused with that. You can also get the Fair City Saints page on Facebook as well. And you can follow myself on Instagram and Twitter at airmiles_17.
Perfect. Well, great. Well, thank you very much for joining me today.
Perfect. No, thank you for having me, Billy.